the Nigerian Constitution and the Awo Road not taken. So I've added Ibori on array to the title. Today, Dr. Mrs. Tokunbo Awolowo Dosumu and the Obafemi Awolowo Foundation have given me the task of commemorating another birthday, albeit posthumously, with a lecture. I'm going to start a birthday lecture business. But this time around, the face being the abode of discourse. So
you should. Okay. Can you still hear me? Although I can't see what I'm reading. Yeah, that's why I came. Okay, good. Okay, is this in back? Hello? Okay, yeah.
But this time around, the face being the abode of discourse, you should be able to tell just by looking at my face and the cap that I'm wearing that today's task is one in which I am infinitely well pleased. My pleasure obviously derives from the fact that we are gathered here on account of a celebrant of a decidedly different hue. We are gathered to celebrate and reflect on the momentous passage of our celebrant and his ideas and ideals through the life of this country at extremely significant moments of its history. In other words, we are gathered here on account of a masquerade who, for every day it pleased his maker to grant him among us, between March 6, 1909 and May 9, 1987, danced exceedingly well. Danced well for himself. Oh, he danced well for his wife and children. Danced well for his people. Oh, he danced well for his country. Danced well for Africa. Oh, he danced well for humanity. And when your masquerade dances well, that Yoruba proverb authorizes you to indulge in self-congratulatory chest beating. Because the masquerade for whom we are gathered here today danced well, we're not going to sing dirges like we did the last time. We are going to celebrate even as we reflect critically and regretfully on could have beens and had we knowns. Last time we did the body count for the celebrant, we looked at the mountains of corpses, especially of the young, and we're still counting those corpses today in Yobe and Borno. A tragic consequence of wholly avoidable errors of the rendering. And we marked that birthday by singing Urun la leda, eh, Urun la leda, Urun la leda, eh, Urun la leda, eh, te gome, te jeuda bau. Today, when we think of the man whose ideas we are here to engage and celebrate, when we think of his dance and how he danced so well to help us avoid the path of self-destruction onto which we pig-headedly launched ourselves anyway, we are in order if we flag all these events leading to the 6th of March 2014 by singing Happy birthday, Papa Awolowo. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday Come on, stand up and sing it. We're celebrating.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Papa.
I told you once that I'm a much better singer than Tonto Dike. You can see the evidence now. Now that we have paid our dues to the celebrant, now that we have cleared the path before us by saluting that great and illustrious ancestor of ours, Chief Obafemi Awolowo, if I continued this lecture beyond this point without other salutations, having saluted the homestead and the farmstead, do I now have the authority to proceed with this lecture? Thank you. We should be thankful to the Obafemi Awolowo Foundation for placing the theme of our assignment today within the philosophical purview of paths, of roads, of journeys through space and time, and ultimately of choices made or not made in the unavoidable human destiny of movement. But to each culture, to each civilization, its particulars of framing the philosophy of roads and paths, of framing the cultural underpinnings of choice, the choice which places your feet as an individual or as a people on this road and not that road. Furthermore, whether you must set forth at dawn or not, and how you go about propitiatory interventions to avoid ending up in the ravenous jaws of the famished road, all fall within the province of cultural predilections. Different cultures, different approaches. Thus it was that in 1916, 7 years after Chief Obafemi Awolowo was born, a certain culture that is conventionally associated with individuality, call it the imperialism of the individual, gave us one of the most famous poems of all times in the English language. Almost 100 years after its publication in 1916, philosophers, philologists, writers and artists, literary critics, and even cultural dilettantes are still debating and trying to interpret its full meaning and intent, with some even claiming that it is the most misread, most interpreted and most misunderstood poem in the history of English poets. And we just got another interpretation from Dr. Dosumu, by the way, in her address. That great poem, ladies and gentlemen, is entitled The Road Not Taken, authored by the famous American poet, Robert Frost. It has already been read to you. I don't think I need to, maybe I should just refresh your memory with the first and the last stanzas. Two roads diverge in the yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler, long I stood and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. I shall be, and then, you know, we have that existential dilemma in the next two stanzas of this guy trying to decide which of the two roads to take. And then the last stanza, he eventually decides to take one of the, because he can't take both. I shall be telling this with a sigh. Somewhere ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. This poem gives us the title of today's proceedings. It is also the unsung and always unreferenced origin of the use of that phrase, the road not taken, in much of our national discourse. However, for our purposes today,
What I want you to pay attention to is the overwhelming evidence of individuality in this poem. There is only one isolated subject speaking of individual choice, destiny, and consequences in this business of taking or not taking a particular route. Notice that this wayfaring Western persona in the poem describes himself as one traveler and treats us to a generous deployment of the personal pronoun I. In three of the four stanzas of the poem, I is I, than I am. If only the speaking subject in Frost's poem had been an African of Chief Obafemi Awolowo's ethnic stock, he would have been faced with an entirely different and ideally more auspicious proposition. For one, he would not have been alone, for in this business of forked and bifurcated roads, the Yoruba worldview allows for the presupposition of the presence and guidance of either those who have gone before and have therefore acquired the requisite experience to guide he or those who follow behind, to borrow a popular Niger speak. Or the presence of those who, even if still here among us, possess such superior intellect and vision as could be deployed for the collective benefit of a people at the critical moment of choice, the choice of roads and paths. In essence, to the aloneness, singularity, and individuality of Frost's confused fictional character, who stands at that critical bifurcation, saying, me, myself, and I must decide which of the two diverging roads to take, the Yoruba world responds with a co-presence which banishes aloneness, a voice of wisdom, prescience, vision, and experience, a superior intellect saying to the lonely traveler, you are not alone, Ibori. This voice, we must insist, is not an intrusion into the private recesses of individual agency at the moment of choice. Rather, it is evidence of a communalist telos designed to deny the validity of lazy alibis and excuses in the event of sad and stubborn wrong choices and decisions. Make the appropriate substitutions, and that singularly forlorn persona in Frost's poem, standing splendidly alone at the point of divergence of two roads, becomes Nigeria at the maturation point of Project Nationhood in the first half of the 20th century. But Nigeria was never going to be alone in that long march to the choice of a road to national destiny. The she-goat was never going to be left alone to suffer the pains of parturition. Project Nationhood, that new space of civic and psychic belonging that was going to be forged out of the inchoate desires of different ethnic nationalities yoked together by colonialism, was singularly blessed by the presence of a stellar cast of nationalist heroes and sheroes, of statesmen and women, some destined for demiurgic roles, some destined for vatic roles, some destined to combine both and even more roles, as they screamed at that emergent nation at the crossroads, Ibori. It is my contention that as far as the constitutional history and trajectory of Nigeria is concerned, Chief Obafemi Awolowo was at once demiurgic, that is, a creator, an originator, and vatic, a visionary. And that for me is what makes his own voice the loudest in the assembly of founding fathers who tried to tell Nigeria, Ibori, honorary. But let us pause to probe these Igbori honorary business further before we begin to unpack how Chief Obafemi Awolowo specifically applied it scrupulously to Nigeria's process of constitutional becoming and what we may learn from his proposals as we march yet again to Abuja for a new round of national dialogue and conversation. The privilege of not being alone at the crossroads, the privilege of enjoying the guidance and co-presence of that cautionary voice of wisdom does not in any way conduce to intellectual laziness and ethical demission at the moment of choice. The role of that voice is purely advisory. The exercise of choice is still your responsibility. In essence, nothing in the Yoruba world compels that patriarch, that matriarch, that visionary voice which stands beside you at the fork in the road to do more than point out which is the road and which is the deceptive option which hides thorns and thistles, potholes and gullies after the very first sharp bend. In essence, if Chief Awolowo had done nothing more than stand with Nigeria at that critical fork in the road to constitution making in the 20th century, if he had done nothing more than show her the choices and the possibilities, saying Nigeria, Igboreo, before turning his back to return to the warm embrace of his wife and children in Ikene, if he had done nothing more than this, he would still have more than largely satisfied the imperatives of his culture. He would have done his bit. He would have done his best. Nothing in that culture compels him to tarry perpetually, to linger permanently in the company of a willfully blind and voluntarily deaf customer like Nigeria, hanging on to the feet of this customer and trying to place them on the right road. In other words, as far as the philosophy of Igbori honore is concerned, any gesture, any action beyond the utterance of that caution is an extraordinary privilege enjoyed by the person or entity being so advised. It is jara, it is supplementary. No sage is compelled to go that far. Ladies and gentlemen, that is precisely why Chief Obafemi Awolowo stands out in terms of his decades-long commitment to Nigeria's constitutional development in particular, and to the overall envisioning of the country's destiny in general. Decade after decade after decade, in book after book after book, in essay after essay after essay, in speech after speech after speech, in action after action after action, what we confront in Chief Awolowo's extraordinary output, especially with regard to constitution making, is precisely that extra mile, that extra gesture, that jara after the solemn and repeated utterance of Igbori. I would therefore want us to consider his expansive body of work, that intellectual tool to force, as fulfilling the dual function of showing Nigeria the difference between the right way and the wrong way to constitutional bliss, and also going the extra length of painstakingly mapping out strategies for traveling on the right way. The theme of this symposium, we must remind ourselves, insists that there is an our road to the Nigerian constitution that was not taken. The temptation is great to begin any analysis of the nature, character, and prescriptions of that road, and while we refused, we meaning Nigeria, to do any mileage on it by focusing on the statesman's 1966 book, Thoughts on Nigerian Constitution, because its title bears the most direct resonance not just to our objectives today, but also, and perhaps more importantly, to Nigeria's ongoing quest for constitutional direction at 53. Doing this would be starting the story in medias res, for the said book is but a significant culmination of a long maturational process of intellectual rigor and prescience with regard to the articulation of a constitutional path for Nigeria. A clear hint of the incipience and long evolution of Chief Awolowo's thought on Nigerian constitutional issues can be found in Awu, his 1960 autobiography. Chapter 12 of the autobiography is entitled Evolution of a Federalist. Here, the thinker declares, and I'm quoting him now, in 1951, when the controversy on the form of Nigeria's constitution began, I had already been for more than 18 years a convinced Federalist. End of quote. The path to this conviction, Chief Awolowo informs us, started as early as 1928, when he encountered the thought and work of Indian nationalists and the Indian National Congress. And we are informed in the preface to Thought on Nigerian Constitution that our thinker has played, quote, a leading role in the work of constitution making in Nigeria since 1949, end quote. What these temporal milestones in the origin and evolution of Chief Awolowo's thought on constitutional federalism confirm is the fact that almost 30 years to independence in 1960, again, I'm thinking of the hint that the seeds of his convictions on the necessity of constitutional federalism for Nigeria were sown as far back as 1928, from the very womb of the colonial incubus, Chief Awolowo was already telling Nigeria, Ibori, he has hardly a book in which a chapter is not dedicated to reiterating the importance of getting Nigeria's constitutional framework right. We already cited chapter 12 of his autobiography. The 1947 book, Path to Nigerian Freedom, actually written in 1945, contains a chapter towards federal union, which as usual makes the case for a federal constitution. In 1968, the People's Republic, that's another book, offers two significant constitutional chapters. Chapter 5 is entitled Constitutional Basis, and chapter 10 is entitled Suitable Constitution. So you pick up any work of the sage, there's got to be some reflection, some direction on the importance of the right constitutional framework for this country. And this is not counting the volume of essays and speeches in which these keywords and registers appear. Indeed, wherever the word constitution appears in the Awolowo opus, you can almost always count on encountering the qualifiers suitable, or even more frequently, federal, which the thinker always poses in a binary opposition to unitary. Wherever or whenever that binary opposition occurs in his work, he resolves the argument, always unambiguously in favor of federalism, recommending it forcefully and repeatedly to Nigeria as honor, and always pointing at unity realism as what? Igbo. we must hasten to point out that Chief Awolowo's use of the word federal or the expression federal constitution bears no resemblance with the blasphemous use of that word in Nigeria's contemporary political discourse and practice. In a reversal of semantics possible only in Nigeria, what we in fact call federalism today is what Awolowo consistently critiques and decries as unitarianism is worth. Not content with launching us onto the path of this asphyxiating unitarianism, the direct heirs of the Unitarians critiqued in Chief Awolowo's work are in fact those claiming to be the federalists of our own day, criminalizing dialogue, imposing no-go areas of national discourse, and mouthing constipated cliches about national unity, corporate existence, and indivisibility of nationhood. They take the dog of unitarianism and go to town to present it to the people as the monkey of federalism. Unlike the political jokers ruling Nigeria today, Chief Awolowo was no victim of conceptual confusion. He was no trafficker in semantic GBT. Hence, in making true federalism the foundation and the essence of the Awolowo to Nigerian constitution and nationhood, he applied himself to a rigorous methodology of definition, explication, exploration, and analysis. This is much evident in Thoughts on Nigerian Constitution, by far his most extended reflection on the subject. What should detain anybody willing to find answers to the contemporary dilemmas and discontents of Project Nationhood in this book is, however, neither the rigor with which the author identifies some 33 accusations leveled against the Constitution of the First Republic after it was suspended, nor the unimpeachable brio with which he delivers his submissions in favor of a genuine federalist constitution. After all, given the condition of Nigeria today, given a report card after 53 years of this experiment, it should by now be visible to the blind and audible to the deaf. Is Patrick over here alone in the audience? Oh, he couldn't make it. I stole that from him. It should be visible to the blind and audible to the deaf that the author of Thoughts on Nigerian Constitution was right on the money about the factors he identified as weighing heavily in favor of true federalism. Identifying these factors which compare federalism is the easy part. How the author arrives at his unshakable conclusion that any nation in which these factors are assembled, but which insists on foraging in constitutional pastures other than federalism is doomed, is an entirely different proposition. How did he didn't just jump up, list these factors, and say, you know, here's the route, you know, take it. No. How he arrives at these conclusions is what should detain us. Let's hear Chief Awolowo in subsection 3 of chapter 2 of the book Under Consideration. We are still dealing with Thoughts on Nigerian Constitution. This is the part where he declares federalism a necessity for Nigeria and not the unitary beast we currently misname federalism. And I quote him, "Our stand in this matter is well known. We belong to the federalist school. Nevertheless, we have elected to adopt a completely objective and scientific approach to our present search and are prepared to abandon our stand if we find reason for doing so. Accordingly, we have made a much more careful study of the constitutional evolution of all nations of the world, with a view to discovering whether any, and if so, what principles and laws govern such evolution, we have found that some countries have satisfactorily solved their constitutional problems, whilst others have so far not. In consequence of our analysis of the two sets of countries, we are able to deduce principles or laws which we venture to regard as sound and of universal application. There are altogether six continents in the world. We will take the continents one by one. And he goes on in this systematic. I do hope that the central claim, I've closed the quotation, so now I'm speaking, not Papa. I do hope that the central claim of the passage that you have just heard has not escaped any of you. To arrive at his scientific conclusions about an appropriate constitutional path for Nigeria, Papa Awolowo assures us that he undertook a study of the constitutional evolution, listen to this, of all the nations of the world. He's not joking. All the nations of the world, of every country in every continent. And if you are tempted to think that he couldn't possibly have done that, he already anticipates you. He assures us thus, quote, "We certainly cannot and should not be expected to give full details of our investigation in this discourse, but we can and certainly will state as briefly as possible the facts from which the principles are deduced. And what, we may ask, you may all ask, is the most significant deduction that our thinker makes from these empirical methodologies." So, the recommendation for this thing, it's empirical, And what is the deduction that Papa makes from this? Let's listen to him. Quote, "In any country where there are divergences of language and of nationality, particularly of language, a unitary constitution is always a source of bitterness and hostility on the part of linguistic or national minority groups. On the other hand, as soon as a federal constitution is introduced in which each linguistic or national group is recognized and accorded regional autonomy, we must repeat this again, regional autonomy and federalism are not enemies. Any bitterness, any hostility against the constitutional arrangements as such disappear. If the linguistic or national group concerned are backward or too weak vis-a-vis the majority group or groups, their bitterness or hostility may be dormant or suppressed. But as soon as they become enlightened and politically conscious, and or courageous leadership emerges amongst them, the bitterness and hostility come into the open and remain sustained with all possible venom and rancor until home rule is achieved." End quote. Ladies and gentlemen, I have questions for you, and I need you to answer these questions. Does the scenario described by Papa Awu above sound familiar? Thank you. Question two. If between 1928, when the seeds of these ideas were sown, and 1966, when Thoughts on Nigerian Constitution was published, if between these two dates, the cripple named Nigeria was given repeated forewarnings of war and doom, does this particular cripple have any excuse for being caught up in wars and rumors of war in 2014?
No.
Okay. What do you call a cripple who gets caught in war even after receiving the benefit of repeated forewarnings and foreknowledge of the impending war? Arotiobo. There are more questions. Do you believe that a man who puts in decades into a systematic study of the constitutional experiments of every nation in the world, drawing valuable experience, lessons, insights, deductions therefrom, has earned the right to be listened to by his own country when he tells her Igbori honorary? Thank you. Apart from true federalism and its associated advantages, the minority question constitutes another significant signpost on the our road to constitution making that was not taken, obviously. Any of these roads that I'm identifying and discussing, I am implying that they are roads not taken. So the minority question detains Papa Awolowo in many of his publications. Indeed, he treats these questions with so much empirical minutiae that a detailed outline of his breakdowns and permutations would have to wait until the discussion part of our proceedings. Suffice it to say that he wants that a federal constitution must at all times be sensitive to minorities and sufficiently malleable to take care of their legitimate fears of domination whenever the need arises, says Chief Awolowo of ethnic minority groups. I'm going to quote Papa again now. We must not group them or any of them with any of the larger and self-sufficient linguistic groups. If we did, we would be placing the small linguistic group or groups concerned in a state of comparative political and social disability. A minority problem would thereby be created which would demand solution. With great respect, we do not think that it is possible to charm, underline that, we do not think that it is possible to charm the minorities and their problems out of existence. The truth is that minorities do and will always exist in Nigeria. Vis-a-vis the majorities, these minorities have their fears, real or imaginary, which can only be allayed by unequivocal and entrenched constitutional arrangements. The minority question can only be handled with unequivocal and entrenched constitutional arrangements. Igbori! Ladies and gentlemen, what do you think has been Nigeria's answer to this particular aspect of the our road? You need not look beyond this podium for Nigeria's answer. Given Igbori honorary and other cultural deployments in this lecture, some of you can be forgiven if by now you have concluded that I am Yoruba. That's what I think too. Well, Nigeria disagrees with you. Nigeria says I'm a northerner. In fact, technically, Nigeria would rather have me silence my Okun Yoruba identity and blend into some northern Lapland in which the beneficence of an umbrella Hausa Fulani identity would take care of all my problems in the Nigerian family. So, Chief Awolowo was, you know, pays a lot of attention and calls for a serious constitutional approach to these kinds of problems. Constitutional guarantees of the financial viability of the constituent parts of the Federal Unit is another key feature of the Awi Road. This need not detain us beyond the observation that we have done the exact opposite of this requirement. And I believe that other key areas of Chief Awolowo's thought, such as the importance of separation of powers, secularity of the Nigerian state, and the need for local government autonomy, can be examined in fuller detail during our discussions. Those are also key aspects of the Awo Road, and we are making a serious mess of each of these, you know, significant propositions. What I propose to do for the rest of the time that I have is to examine a number of issues which Chief Awolowo himself admits may strike the average person as trivial and unworthy of discussion in the context of constitutional considerations. However, the significance of these false trivia can only be measured by the heavy price Nigeria pays today for failing to pay adequate constitutional attention to them. Perhaps the attention that Chief Awolowo pays to such issues as would appear to the ordinary man as trivia is also because he understands that they can combine to vitiate what he calls the social objectives of a federal constitution. And he has a lot to say about the social objectives of the constitution. It is under these social objectives that he addresses a wide range of issues in consonance with his socialist persuasion, such as education, health, human capital development, employment, and poverty. If you are tempted to think that a constitution is not a party manifesto and should not be dabbling into social objectives, Chief Awolowo already anticipates your train of thought and preempts you in this passage. Quote, "It may be objected that all we have been saying has been talking about health, about education, about a whole range of issues. It may be objected that all we have been saying has nothing to do with constitution making. Our emphatic answer is that it has a mighty lot to do with it. Our experience during the past 6 years has shown that though we are ostensibly free as a nation, yet as a people we remain tightly shackled in the chains of ignorance, disease, want, and native tyranny. It is a duty which we owe to ourselves and to future generations of Nigerians to ensure, as far as human ingenuity can contrive it, that the demons which held us enthralled under the old constitution are fought and destroyed under the new constitution." Ibori, what then are these false trivia that could stand in the way of a constitution achieving its stated social objectives? What are these? Chief Awolowo is describing some issues as apparent trivialities, but at the same time saying they are so important. If you don't pay attention to them, if you don't provide for them in the constitution, they could derail even the very essence of your nationhood. What are these things? Let me give you an example. How many of you in this hall have ever given a thought to the fact that the convoys of our government officials could stand in the way of the constitution and of national progress? If you'd never made a connection between the constitution and the convoys, which always drive you Nigerian citizens off the road whenever an oga at the top is passing, unless if they are obeying, you will not be driven off the road. If the answer of Benny, they don't drive people off the road. I understand that. You know, but those are exceptions to the rule. So, if you've never given a thought to that proposition that there is a linkage between a convoy and the constitution, here is what Chief Awolowo has to say. I'm quoting. "In the fourth place, some people may wonder whether it is necessary to make provision in the constitution forbidding the Prime Minister and Premier and their ministers to make use of the services of police orderlies and outriders and to inspect a guard of honor. Papa's attention to detail. He is saying that convoys, the number of convoys must be, you know, there must be constitutional provision banning convoys. And then he continues. Listen to him. The unfortunate thing, however, is that these little and trivial looking things had contributed in no small measure to the tenacity of office on the part of those who held these offices under the First Republic. They had imagined that their individual ego would be deflated almost to the point of political extinction if they were deprived of these empty and vain trappings. Papa is not done yet. They have therefore been driven to practice all kinds of chicanery and vice in order to remain in office. We must not allow our public men to develop this type of warped sense of value in the future. End of quote. Poor Chief Awolowo. How could this phenomenal thinker have known that almost 3 decades after his death, these public men would even allow their constitutionally unrecognized wives to develop a warped sense of value, shut down Lagos, Abuja, and Port Harcourt whenever they come to town, harass elected state governors, and dip their hands into our national treasury at will to fund the federal monuments to their ego that the next First Lady will erase entirely? Baba was worrying about the men. He didn't know that their wives was there.